Welcome on this fourth Sunday of Easter. We are an Easter people, people of the resurrection, and we celebrate life. We celebrate God's goodness that touches our lives every day. I want to thank you so much for tuning in and joining us. Your involvement in that way and just watching our service and letting us share some comments and stuff, that helps us and encourages us. We thank you so much. It's always good to be reminded, where two or three are gathered in Jesus' name, there he is among us. And so even though this room feels kind of empty and it's a little different to lead worship to just a handful of people, we know that you're gathering together and celebrating with family. And so may you feel the presence and God's blessing as you gather for worship. Would like to remind you or let you know that on this, the first Sunday of the month, that we're going to have Holy Communion as part of our service. So if you need to gather some bread or some crackers, juice or some kind of drink, turn up the volume a little bit while you leave and you'll hear a couple more announcements. The Ministry Board is planning a Zoom meeting for Monday, May the 4th at 6 p.m. We've heard from a few that that time probably isn't going to work for them, but just want to be thinking, and we move into the governor's phases, what that might mean for the church and when we might realistically and safely gather together as a congregation and have worship. And so we'll be looking at just two items on our agenda for Monday night. Today we would have honored our graduates in our worship today and anticipation of their high school graduation and eighth grade promotion and so on. And so we have the graduates with their photos listed there in the newsletter, and I hope that you as a congregation might remember them and reach out to them. I would lift up as special prayer concerns the Donovan Kirk family. Had a graveside last Wednesday, and the family very strongly plans to have a full memorial service when that is possible later in the summer. I thought I would lift up that we should be in prayer for Nehemaw County. We have now one person that's contacted the COVID-19 virus, and so we need to pray for that person, even though I don't know who that is, but to pray for them and to pray for our county's protection and safety, that we would continue to take safe measures to protect ourselves, and we would pray for the list of our church family that we have in the on the newsletter. Just a word of personal encouragement. As restrictions are lifted, let me encourage you to maintain the regimen of what you've been doing to be safe, to wear a face mask in public, frequently washing your hands for 20 seconds, and keeping that safe distancing of 6 feet or more from other people as reasonably as possible. That's brought us through and helped us to flatten the curve. And so let's continue to work on those things to make us safe. And so I would end our announcement time by saying, be safe and do no harm. Or our opening hymn is, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is thy Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Oh, pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 besides. Yeah. And great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Lord, every morning new mercies I see, and all I have needed thy hands have provided. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, Lord.
Well, I hope you sounded pretty good at home. Next, we would have our children's time, and Josh has been pretty popular on Facebook as people have tuned in to see that. And, oh, he's got bright colors for us today. Oh, next week. This was a busy, busy week, and I didn't say thanks to all those who came to our mystery movie night and for the technical staff for putting that on for us. We really appreciated that. So we're ready for a special music number from our praise team.
Thank you.
Now we'd like to spend some time preparing our hearts for a time of Holy Communion, lifting up our prayers to God. And in a few moments, I'll lead us in a pastoral prayer. And then we'll conclude our prayer time with the Lord's Prayer. So let's come to the Lord now in prayer. Father God, we honor you and we worship you. We want to express to you that we are crazy in love with you, that you mean so much to us, that you're there all the time for us. We value that, and we know that you are amazing. You are holy, complete, and perfect in all your ways. We praise you, and we ascribe to you glory, power, and honor. You amaze us with your wisdom and your perfect timing, your complete faithfulness and the way that you act on our behalf. We thank you for all your blessings, for your constant watch and care that you give to us. Lord, we want to acknowledge that your thoughts are higher than our thoughts, that your ways are different from our ways. You forgive and you pardon when we would hold a grudge. Lord, we confess that we are sinners. And we ask for your forgiveness and for your mercy. Jesus, thank you for your sacrifice that makes our forgiveness possible. Remind us that nothing shall separate us from your never-failing love. Lord, you know how the COVID-19 pandemic has affected our nation, our state, and our world. I pray that you would keep safe the medical professionals on the front line. Give them rest for their souls, refresh them, and provide them with new energy. Thank you for all who have been able to keep their jobs, for all who have been able to be providers and to provide services for the rest of us. We ask you to watch over them and bless them. Be with those who anticipate returning to work. And pray that their jobs are doable, that there are places for them to go and ways for them to be productive. Watch over them and bless them. Lord, help us to look to you, to thank you for your care and your watching over us, your steadfast love, protecting us from the potential harm of this pestilence. Help us to call on you as our shield and our defender, the one who will deliver us. And we praise you, Jesus. We give you thanks. We rejoice in you. Lord, we pause to thank you for technology, the technology that allows us to have worship today, or the special technology that the schools are employing that they might engage their students and help them to finish their school year. I'm thinking of our high school seniors. There have been disappointments and challenges for them. We pray that they finish strong, that they learn to walk with you, that you would teach them and call them to seek the abundant life that you would offer them and bless them with. Help them to come to you, the one who holds their future in your hands. You have a job, you have a plan. You have a purpose for each one of them. Bless their families. Bless them. May they face the future with confidence because of you. We thank you, Jesus. Lord, as a church, open our eyes to the potential ministries and opportunities that you've set before us. They may have changed. They may look differently right now. But there's still opportunities to share good news, to expand the influence of your kingdom, and to advance your cause in the world. We desire, Lord, for you to be lifted up, for you to be glorified. So we lift up our prayers in the name of Jesus, God's only Son, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Now, if you would, please join with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We gather together for Holy Communion. Normally I would look out and see a congregation of people anxious and eager to come to the Lord's table to break bread and to receive the elements of the bread and the cup, to be refreshed by God's grace, to be reminded and affirmed in that covenant promise that Christ has given us eternal life, that we can live together forever with him. And so take a moment there in your home and prepare the bread or get your juice or your cup ready. We'll share together the familiar words of our great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right, a good and joyful thing always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Jesus, you told us, I am the bread of life. And you came to satisfy everyone's hunger. Only you can satisfy that empty feeling in the human soul. You know how to give life, the kind that is filled with meaning, rich experiences that give joy and hope and peace and love. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and we join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Let us share the news that when Jesus suffered and died upon the cross, you took upon yourself our sin and our death and destroyed their power forever. You raised Jesus from the dead, and now he reigns with you in glory. So as we share this meal together, we remember the church. And in each person's face, we can see Jesus. On the night before meeting with death, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks to you. He broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, Jesus took a cup. He gave thanks to you. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us who are gathered here and all of those watching at home, that they may feel the presence of your power and that they may be reminded that in the breaking of this bread, in the drinking of this cup, that we may know the presence of the living Christ and be renewed as the body of Christ for the world, redeemed by Christ's blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in his final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. So as you have made your hearts right with God, right with one another, with everyone who is present there with you in your setting, or with those that are parts of our congregation or neighbors, friends, that our hearts might be right, that God might forgive us, bless us, and extend his grace freely. And so we come. We come in the love of Christ. We come to be blessed. We come to be reminded of the assurance that sin and death are defeated, that Christ's peace is offered to us. We have such a great hope. And so we invite those to come. Why don't you step back? We're going to form a little like circle here, okay? So you break off a piece of bread, take and eat, and know that Christ's love and his blood was shed for you. Now, if you'll take that, can you break off a piece? You can have more than that. God bless you. Body and blood of Christ shed for you because he loves you so much. Okay? Take and receive of his gift of life and love. Know that Jesus loves you. That he fills us with his Spirit. He surrounds us and keeps us in the strength and power of his love. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Okay. All right, you can go back to your seats. Well, I hope everyone's had a time to serve communion and to share words of grace and love with each other. Here in the sanctuary, we're ready to move to the giving of our love gifts to God, of giving our tithes and our offerings. So, thank you for your gifts and remembering the church. Thank you for being faithful and steadfast. We pray now our prayer of dedication. Blessed are you, O God, from whom all good things come. With thankful hearts, we return to you a portion of what you have given us, dedicating both gifts and the givers to your service. Receive them for the sake of Jesus, who offered himself for us. For it's in his name that we pray. Amen. Today's scripture reading comes from the Gospel of Luke. We're in chapter 4. We'll read the first 13 verses. And Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness for 40 days, being tempted by the devil. And he ate nothing during those days. And when they were ended, he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become bread." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God." And the devil took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time, and said to him, "To you I will give all this authority and their glory, for it has been delivered to me, and I give it to whom I will. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." And Jesus answered him, "Get behind me, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." And he took him to Jerusalem and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." And Jesus answered him, "It is said, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test." When the devil had ended every temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. Today's message is entitled, "Was Jesus Really Tempted?" And I would also say that this begins a brief sermon series that looks at identity, authority, and faith. There's some very important things going on here. One, Jesus elevates the importance of God's word. Three times the devil presents temptations, and three times Jesus will respond with the power of God's word. The scripture is very important for us to deal with our temptations. Then number two, our identity is very important. You have to know who you are and that you belong to God. Let's talk about identity for a moment. In Luke's gospel, right before this encounter of Jesus going into the wilderness, he presents Jesus as being baptized by John the Baptist in the River Jordan. So if we would go back to chapter 3, verses 22, we would have this experience. "And the Holy Spirit descended upon him in bodily form as a dove, and a voice came from heaven, 'Thou art my beloved Son, with thee I am well pleased.'" Jesus had his identity confirmed at his baptism. I'm not saying it was in question. I'm just saying he knew that he knew. Here, as the Trinity, the three come together, we have two things of significance. God the Father says, "Thou art my beloved Son, with thee I am well pleased." And then second, you have the appearance of the Holy Spirit, who Jesus sees in the form of a dove. It comes and lands on his shoulder, and that's his anointing, the filling of the Holy Spirit, so we can be certain that Jesus knows who he is. This is an eternal reunion. Before Jesus fully engages in his ministry, the Holy Spirit then leads him into the wilderness. So you have, I know my identity, I know my purpose, I know my ministry, I know my mission, but there's one more thing that needs to take place. So the Holy Spirit leads Jesus into the wilderness, verses 1 and 2. "And Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit for 40 days in the wilderness, tempted by the devil. And he ate nothing in those days, and when they were ended, he was hungry." So Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to fast and to pray. So he's been fasting and only drinking water for 40 days. Have you ever fasted? Is that a spiritual discipline that you've ever tried? Fasting is one of those disciplines designed to help us draw closer to God. Some people fast for a 24-hour period of time. Some for shorter periods, maybe 6 or 4 or 2 hours at a time. Fasting isn't just saying, I'm going to skip this meal. It's a time dedicated that somewhere in that fast, 6 hours, 8 hours, 24 hours, there are times where you set aside what you're doing and you stop and you worship God. You read the scriptures or you meditate. You let God speak to your heart. It's a time of cleansing your spirit, emptying your soul, and letting God refresh and renew and energize you. So I would suggest fasting can help focus your mind, make you more aware of God's presence, and give you energy and determination for something that God is speaking to you on your heart that you can follow through, that you can accomplish that. So back to Jesus and his 40 days without food. Can you imagine the rumble in your tummy? That feeling that you're so hungry. Jesus was vulnerable. When are you most vulnerable? When you've gone through periods of time where your rest is sleepless, or it's not fulfilling, or times when you're weak or you're feeling sick? How about when you're bored? Or how about during a time right after a great accomplishment when there's that letdown? When are you most vulnerable? The devil attacked Jesus with a very powerful seduction. This was a real temptation. The devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, command this stone to become bread. If you are who you claim to be, the Son of God, here's the identity question. The biggest part of this temptation is for Jesus to prove that he's the Son of God. It would go a long way to proving that he's the Son of God if he could turn a hard, compacted stone into a warm, freshly baked loaf of bread. The devil is always trying to create doubt. If you are. But Jesus knew with certainty that he is the Son of God. If you are, turn the stone to bread to satisfy your hunger. Our hunger, our appetites, are a very powerful desire that builds inside us. And it's one of those things that we need to learn how to control. Oh, this temptation was real. Jesus stands up to the devil and he quotes from Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3. This is how it reads. And he humbled you and let you hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man does not live by bread alone, but that man lives by everything that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord. Everything that God says should get our attention and be important to you and to me. I want to take a few moments to look at some verses that lift up God's word. You probably know that the Bible is referred to as the sword of the Spirit in Ephesians 6:17. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. That comes out of Paul's list of the whole armor of God. Or how about Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12? For the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. God's word is living and active and able to divide and cut between soul and spirit. I want to suggest to you that is sharp. The word of God can turn away the devil's attempts to deceive you and bring you harm. You need to boldly be prepared to speak God's word in faith, and the devil will turn and leave you alone. The next temptation is a little more involved. Let me read verses 5 through 7 in chapter 4. And the devil took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time, and said to him, "To you I will give all this authority and their glory, for it has been delivered to me, and I give it to whom I will. If you then will worship me, it shall all be yours." All the kingdoms of the earth were now the devil's because of Adam and Eve. They gave them away when they sinned against God. The devil could do with them as he wished. Now Jesus knew that the kingdoms of the world would belong to him someday. They would become his. So part of the temptation is twofold. One, to claim what could belong to him, and to know that he would rule and take care of people in the world better than what the devil was doing. And it would be a shortcut. It would avoid the agony and the pain and the separation between Father and Son at the cross. Jesus' night of anguish in the Garden of Gethsemane shows us how real this temptation must have been. But what would Jesus have given up? What would he lose if he took this shortcut? If he bowed down and worshiped the devil, he would break the first commandment. "You shall have no other gods before me," found in Exodus 20, verse 3. Jesus would also break his Father's heart and would give up his perfect, sinless life. In Luke chapter 4, verse 8, we have Jesus' response. "It is written, 'You shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve.'" By holding on to the word of God, Jesus was honoring the Father and giving the Father glory as being worthy of worship and our complete allegiance. The third temptation, found in 9 through 11. "And he took him to Jerusalem and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to him, 'If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will give his angels charge of you to guard you. And on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone.'" So the devil takes Jesus to the highest part of the temple and has him looking down and encourages him, "Now look, just jump off. Just give it a jump. The angels will catch you." So Satan is using his craft and subtlety to quote scripture from Psalm 91, referring to the angels will take charge over you and catch you so that your foot doesn't stub your toe on a stone. But once again, the devil's also bringing in the question of his identity. "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here." So built into this temptation is that invitation to show off. To show off. To let people see how special you are. To puff up and to say, "Look at me, everybody. Look what I can do." It's that opportunity for Jesus to reveal himself as the Son of God when all the angels come and gather around and catch him, and everyone would be in awe. They would be amazed. But Jesus answered him, "It is said, 'You shall not tempt the Lord your God.'" For the third time, Jesus stands on the power of God's word, and he uses the authority and the power of God's word to turn the devil away. Listen to Deuteronomy 6:16. "You shall not put the Lord your God to the test, as you tested him in Massah." The Lord our God is one. He is the only God. And as such, he relates to us out of his love. Because God is love, he always begins with his love. And his desire is that you grow to trust him, to rely on him, to believe in him. To put God to the test is to doubt and to not trust him and to turn his love away. The conclusion, concluding verse 13. "And when the devil ended every temptation, He departed from him until an opportune time. Now you might hear in those words, and when the devil had ended every temptation, and think that he emptied his whole arsenal of temptations on Jesus, and so therefore he had to leave. Please don't be mistaken and give the devil too much credit. He does not have a limitless number of temptations to pull on you. And he does not have limitless power. Listen to what John the Apostle says in 1 John chapter 2, verse 16, as he describes for us the three categories of temptations. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but it is of the world. These three categories of temptations all cover the three that the devil used to tempt Jesus. By giving the devil limitless power and abilities, you have made him bigger than he is. The truth is, we can look at 1 Corinthians 10:13. No temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond your strength. But with the temptation will also provide the way of escape, that you may be able to endure it. God is faithful and will provide you a way out. That might mean that he will help you recall a scripture appropriate to the time, just as Jesus recalled scriptures and used that power to put off Satan. Or the Holy Spirit might help you bring to your mind something to worship God for. As I was thinking about this, you might use something familiar like the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. You could pick out verses that are appropriate for your situation and that temptation. And it's always good to just start to worship the Lord. Devil, you're not going to have the victory now. I belong to Jesus Christ. So use your identity as a child of God and present that to Satan. Let's also add now James chapter 4, verse 17. Submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. So claim that promise. When you resist, it means to stand against, to withstand, or to repel. Be bold and speak God's word to the devil. Tell him he is defeated. Tell him that only Jesus Christ has the victory in your life, and he will flee from you. As we lift up our faith as Easter people, believing in the power of the resurrection, we will certainly encounter the devil trying to ensnare us, trying to tempt us, and to tangle us up in lies and deception. But we have the example of Jesus to know how, to follow, and to know that we too can beat the temptations. May the power of God's word come to you. May you rely on it and trust in it, that living word of God. And may you see that God gives you the victory. May the Holy Spirit come in his peace and grace to you, and God bless you. Amen. Well, it's in the Easter season, and it's always good in Easter time to sing a song called Lord of the Dance. Let's sing along or enjoy this song.
I danced in the morning when the world was begun, and I danced in the moon and the stars and the sun. And I came down from heaven and I danced on the earth. At Bethlehem I had my birth. So dance wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance at thee. I lead you all wherever you may be, and I lead you all in the dance at thee. I danced for the scribe and the Pharisee. They would not dance and they would not follow me. And I danced for the fishermen, for James and John. They came to me and the dance went on. So dance wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance. blessed be, and I lead you all wherever you may be, and I lead you all in the dance of me. I danced on the Sabbath when I cured the lame. The holy people said it was a shame. They whipped and they stripped me and they hung me high. They left me there on a cross to die. Dance, dance, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance at thee. And I lead you all, wherever you may be. And I lead you all in the dance at thee. I danced on a Friday when the sky turned black. It's hard to dance with the devil on your back. They buried my body and they thought I'd gone, but I am the dance and I still go on. Dance, dance, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance at thee. And I lead you all wherever you may be, and I lead you all in the dance at thee. Down and I leapt up high. I am the life that'll never, never die. I live in you if you live in me. I am the Lord of the dance at He. Dance, dance, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance at He. And I lead you all wherever you may be, and I lead you all the dance at the dance.
I'll receive now this benediction. Christ, our risen Savior, wants to fill you with life, to give you the courage and the confidence to dance. To dance in the face of the enemy, to dance with confidence that you have a victory. So may peace and joy and hope fill your lives. May you walk and travel in the love of God. We pray this now in Jesus' name. Amen.